Welcome to Monday Night TPK.
Hey, welcome back. This is Monday Night TPK. My name is Kyle, and I will be the DM for this 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons Real Play podcast. Dana is nodding her head in approval, so I guess that means I hit all of the bullet points that I have in my head for what I'm supposed to say when I introduce this thing that we're doing.
D&D 5e Real Play Podcast.
Is that the order I have to say it in?
I don't pay any attention
to the order I say it. I have a list of things that describe this podcast. There's other things also, but they're not all polite.
Or...
For our three listeners out there.
Hi, Sam.
Oh, the other one.
Jim said he was going to start downloading stuff and listening to it, too.
He better.
I told him to skip everything in, what was it? Baldur's Gate.
The Thunderlock?
The whole, first 8 episodes. Alright, so anyway, around me at the table are... For people who really love puzzles, we've been talking about the puzzle that's currently in front of us, and I don't know if they came to a solution or not, because I kind of stopped listening to their deliberations. I feel like it's more fun that way for me. So, Matt, yes. I see you've got a sketch there that you're sketching out.
I do.
Is that pertinent to what we've been discussing?
Yes, it is. It is the door that has blown two of us across the room.
Very cool.
Yeah. It is all of the squares that we have touched that did or did not set off the trap.
Very good, very good. Hey, Ryan.
Yes?
I see that you have approximately a mountain load of dice in front of you.
Yes.
How many of those dice do you anticipate actually using tonight?
I see at least several D20s, obviously. Several D6s, yes. D4s, Needles to Magic Missile.
Alright, cool. Well,
probably mainly just D20s, and if I don't like what the D20 did to me, it gets chucked to the side and no one gets pulled.
It always depends on the day. I mean, I've had games where I literally roll no dice.
I got this one now. This one really does not like Matt, so...
Crystal.
So you're using a die that you know dislikes one of your teammates here?
He only uses it when I'm DMing.
Got it.
Because it nat-20s a lot when I'm DMing, and I don't know why.
Weird.
It hates me.
Weird the kinds of things people obsess about. Sam, I'm trying to find something in front of you here to pick on you for. You got half a glass of milk.
Yeah.
Was the chili too spicy? You're trying to cleanse your palate?
That was the initial reason, and then I just wanted more milk, and now I'm going to work on it. The donut was especially delicious with milk, so thank you guys for that.
No problem. Thank you for the chili.
Yeah, yum, yum.
Dana, you're playing with an index card you have folded.
Oh, yeah.
What does your index card say?
It is folded to like a little tent, and it says +1 inspiration, because I always forget to use my inspiration.
Do you still have inspiration currently?
I do not, because I forgot to use my inspiration, and then I finally used my inspiration, and then I made this. So I haven't actually used it yet.
So eventually you will have inspiration.
In a little marker to remind me, yes.
Very good, very good. So last week was a frustrating encounter with... a pit trap and some blades and some fire and some thunder.
We should have gone with our alternate podcast title of Puzzles Are Hard.
It's true. Luckily for you, this is the only dungeon-style puzzle in the entirety of the Tomb of Annihilation book.
Woohoo! He's kind of shaking his head. I wasn't looking.
Look, if I am lying to you, there are no negative consequences for me, so...
But, I mean, yeah.
That's true.
Although there totally is a reason why Maggie's not playing anymore.
I mean, Not because of me, because of what the subject material is.
I know, I'm not saying
it. Okay. Because Maggie hates dungeons.
Maggie absolutely hates dungeons.
Hopefully she comes back whenever Matt starts DMing again.
Yeah, I want to try to... I want to do dungeons still, but I want to make them go through a lot faster. Like, this seems like it's going to be short. You said we're close. So, like, I feel like maybe, like, 5 to 6 room dungeons is not bad. Definitely not as big as the pyramid that you guys went through last campaign. Definitely not something that big.
Yeah.
It's 10 rooms or less.
Alright. So, Sam.
Yes.
After the craziness which was last week. Mm-hmm. I know you took some amazing notes.
I hope so.
Do you care to read any of those notes?
Sure. Why don't I just read all of them?
Your call.
Cool. Alright, so, last time, on episode 38, we divided up supplies and people... Oh, start again. We divided up the supplies and people, and then rode over to the abandoned camp. We saw lots of wreckage and burned bits of campsite, lots of tents, big and small, and a small panicked bird near a big statue. We found permanent buildings were destroyed, and a rectangular building was at the back of the camp. Ravain went to the feet of the statue, and Rixer went to check out the bird. Brielle and Gilly followed Rixer to look at the bird. Brielle knew it was a young axe-beak and warned Gilly, so Gilly could warn Rixer. We all went up to the feet of the statue, and we saw doors open wide. We slowly ventured inside the door, and it's dark in there. We lit a torch and moved forward. Rixer stepped into a pit trap and fell 20 feet. That was the beginning of our end. Brielle sent a rope down to retrieve Rixer, and Brielle attempted to look for more traps. Brielle jumped the gap and continued to look for more traps. Rixer threw Gilly over the pit and knocked over Brielle. Ravain jumped the pit. Brielle checked the floor again and didn't find anything and backed up. And Brielle got cut by a wall trap. Brielle used a casting of the Detect Magic wand. And on the 7-foot ledge above, she sensed... What did we decide that was? Abjuration?
I told you it was divination.
Right.
But I should have told you it was abjuration.
Abjuration magic.
Oops.
Ravain said someone could be watching us. Brielle attempted to throw up her grappling hook, which is a funny sentence. When it was tagged out.
That would hurt.
But she meant to throw it up onto the ledge above.
Projectile vomit.
And the rope just goes. Rixer jumped the pit and attempted to jump up the wall. And Rixer got sliced midair. Oh, that's right. You just jumped through all of the... Yep. Rixer made it to the edge of the 7-foot ledge and found a 10-foot space. He also found smaller squares carved into the floor. Rixer attempted to look for traps and found a door with a 3x4 grid on it, on a ledge above. Brielle did a standing jump to pull up onto the ledge where Rixer was at. Ravain created an illusion of Rixer to put in the middle of the blades and nothing happened. Ravain cast fog cloud so Gilly and Ravain and Iku could run. So everybody prepared to run. We ran across the path and got hit by blades anyway. But everyone made it up onto the next ledge. And we decided to work on the grid puzzle, which was all abjuration magic. Within the small grid on the floor, we found a pattern that got us to safety. The not correct squares caused a row of fire to appear. So, nobody lit on fire for very long. And we all made it across. And Ravain marked the way to safety. Briel decided to take the path first and climbed up the ledge because Gilly jumped back. Then Rixer and Gilly climbed up, and the group found a 5-foot space and then a wall with a door in the middle. And the door had a 4x4 grid on it with a safe spot pattern marked into it. There was also a glyph of warding on the door. Ravain thought that the grid is a keypad, hence pushing in the safe spots on the grid would be the key to opening the door. So Gilly punched the safe spots into the keypad and got pushed back 10 feet and lit on fire from the fire ground traps after pushing the third safe spot in the code. So Gilly was lying unconscious in a fire trap. Rixer picked her up like a ragdoll. Rixer brought Gilly to Iku. Iku healed Gilly and brought her back to life. Gilly healed herself and Ravain. Brielle tried the reverse of the safety pattern and flew back immediately after pushing the first square. Rinse and repeat, fly back, light on fire. And at the end, Gilly is ready to get out of here.
All right, so that's kind of where you guys stand. Rixer was straddling some of the safe places along the puzzle floor, where basically everybody else is standing along a narrow strip just above the blade trap. And that's, like I said, basically where we left off. Where or what happens next?
I need to heal. Did I heal you last? Or are you still...
I'm up. I have 14 health left, so I'm up.
So you're up and breathing and conscious. Yes. And too badly? Like, are you still smoldering? Would you appreciate some more, like, padding out with additional feel-good medicines, or...
She's...
Are you coughing smoke?
She probably still looks pretty beat up. But also, you know that she's gonna just shrug it off and make it look like it didn't hurt as bad as it did.
Yeah, of course. So, Brielle is conscious, but still kind of smoldering and pretending like she's big and strong.
She is big and strong.
And not severely injured.
She's also severely injured.
Yeah. Gilly's gonna pat her on the back and give her a first level cure wounds. Ooh, nice. So that will be... Hold on a second. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 12 more points of healing.
She looks a lot better now.
Yeah, I bet she does.
Some of the burned skin, like, moistens back out from the dry, crispy appearance.
It's like Wolverine healing.
Sure, some cuts and spices. Cuts and spices.
Cuts and spices, yeah.
Cuts and spices go away.
Ouch.
Yeah. Episode title.
Cuts and spices.
Ravain's just kind of pacing in space, looking at the floor grid and glancing up at the door grid. Just, what are we missing?
Sure.
We would like to roll an investigation.
I was just going to say.
You probably have a higher one than I can. I do, but I am trained in it, so I can help you.
So Brielle uses the helping action or whatever to let Ryan or Ravain do with advantage.
Okay. Which two do I want to use here? We're doing pretty good. So I'll make like a old 60s, 70s cartoon and look for clues.
Do it.
Let me play some old Scooby-Doo music.
I wasn't naming names. That's pretty high off the bat. have advantage, so I'll take the higher one. 22.
So you're immediately close to the floor trap.
Yeah, I climbed down from the door, so I wasn't going to get blasted by the...
Cool, so you're on the... Okay, and you probably were very careful to walk on just the right squares.
I don't remember crossing it. Was it possible not just to drop down without crossing
it? You can drop down to the spot, the last safe spot.
Yeah,
and you'd then have make to, your way back.
You'd have to drop down directly onto the last safe spot.
Okay.
And then make your way back.
So are you on the last safe spot, or are you back with the rest of the party?
I'll be with the rest of the party.
Okay. So either way, you're on the ledge with the puzzle floor.
Right, yep.
Right? What really catches your attention, Brian, Ruvain, is very fainted paintings along the walls of the room. And what you see is a depiction of a man, similar to the one that this whole temple is carved out, carrying the crocodile on his shoulders as he is walking across the desert. And you feel like that has possibly some significance. And you had over 20, right?
Yeah, I got 22.
Yeah. With over 20, you think to then kind of look to the level below you. Because you can see down to the section that had, like, the swinging blade trap. And you see a similar painting of a man carrying a crocodile on his shoulders. Walking very casually through a forest. Like a jungly forest with vines hanging down. And then you can see, like snakes in the trees just kind of, like, staying up there watching them. Mm-hmm.
And the desert is the fire.
Yeah. I will comment on that. I will say, there's an awful lot of depictions of someone being carried. We know from the fable that the man carried the crocodile in exchange for being carried around through the river.
What about water? Like, this is fire.
Didn't
it was hot.
We have to cross water first.
If you think,
wasn't that the first thing?
In the first part of the story that Iku told you before you came in here, she said that the man rowed across the crocodile
on the river,
to cross the river to safety.
And then after that, was there anything like any specific like where they went, or is it just that then the man carried the crocodile?
The man carried the crocodile across the realms of man.
From here, looking up where the door is at, can I see if there's another painting up there?
Give me an investigation, but because you know what you're looking for, I'll let you have advantage on it. Although because you're further away in the angle, the DC is also going to be harder.
So I'll take the 17. That's a plus 4, so 18, 20, 21.
Alright, you broke 20. You can't make out the whole thing, just because of the angle.
Right.
But you can see another painting, faded, just like then worn and covered in some cobwebs. And you can see, you can't really see the man, but you can see the crocodile. And you would probably presume on the man's shoulders. And the crocodile and probably the man are standing in front of a wall, like a city wall or a gate. And you can see the crocodile putting out one of its forelegs to touch the door. Or the gate itself.
The gate, yeah. Braille's gonna kind of, since we're both looking around, she's gonna pat, what is your name?
Ruvain.
Ruvain. Pat Ruvain on the chest and then point up towards it. Kind of point it out.
From the angle of Ruvain, you don't really see anything different. You would probably need to be up there to really see the whole thing.
Yeah, Bria will start gesturing and making signs that like we should get up there to look at it.
She says we should get up there.
I'm right next to you.
Oh, okay.
I just cast Cure Wounds.
I mean, that's bad.
Maybe we can get a closer look at the painting again.
Once more.
I mean, at least we know the path, so... Rhea will start hopping the path.
Rixer!
And then pull herself up.
Toss. Yeah. Sorry, sir.
No, everybody pauses and Sam's like, bleh, and then somebody's like, that. You're fine, love.
Rixer! Toss me!
Rixer's going to pick up Gilly and just kind of like toss her straight up in the air like he was a little kid.
No, on the ledge.
That's a point of inspiration. Yes.
Although at the same time,
we.
I'm not a child, but we. That was fun.
Oh, okay. Are you sure?
Mm-hmm. Okay. I won't touch the buttons this time.
Give me an athletics. I mean, or you can make it. I'll make an attack roll.
No, I don't think that does any damage.
No, but you want her to like land.
Yes, I want it to be accurate.
That's at a true. Place, Sam. Sure.
I thought you were still straddling, so I thought like toss would just be like a gentle like.
Well,
not and like a.
I am on the tiles. I don't remember exactly which tiles I was on.
Oh, well, I guess Sam was right. So I guess you guys can just kind of like gently like.
Okay, just like up.
Yeah. Whee!
Yeah, okay.
All right, cool. So Brielle's up there. Gilly's up there. Now that you're up on top of this ledge, closest to the door, you can see the full painting on the wall. And it is the man with the crocodile on his shoulder, standing in front of a walled city of some sort. And both the man and the crocodile are touching the door, with the man, you know, touching at one point, and then the crocodile above him touching it, obviously, a higher point.
So maybe we have to touch two points at the same time?
Maybe. Oh. Or there's like a time delay. So like one can't be without pressure for too long, otherwise it explodes. Pew! I saw my light flash before my eyes. That was scary.
For the first one that Brielle pushed. Made her go flying.
That's true.
But the first one that Gilly touched did not make her go flying.
The first two that Gilly touched did not make her go flying.
And you touched them one and then the other, not at the same time.
Right.
Well, yeah, she's saying maybe there's a delay, like you have to do it quick enough. But anyway.
So,
Or maybe two people have. Or one person.
The last
to touch
two can't
the
be touched
one.
By the same person.
Same person,
yep.
Or no, well, because she touched the two at the bottom, so maybe somebody has to touch the two at the bottom,
yep.
And at the same time, and then another person touches the two at the top.
Yeah, I think that's pretty much what Ryan was saying. Somebody else has to do the last two.
Huh? I don't want to do that again. But I guess I will. If you guys think. That's right, but I almost think you should be, like, entirely certain. Because as the risk advisor of this group, I am feeling as though my power cannot sustain us constantly dying for much longer.
I'll make sure to catch you this time, Gilly.
Oh, good, because the fire...
Yeah, it's hot.
I mean, I was unconscious, but it hurt when I woke up, so that would be great if I could not light on fire. I'll do it again. Who's gonna go with me?
Can I investigate the door itself?
Yeah.
See if there's anything on the...
Yeah, give me an investigation check.
It's a 15.
You find a glyph of warning.
Did we find that last time? We did find that last time.
Yeah. Oh, did you?
I think we did.
It's very, very faint, but it is just a lot, like, behind the entire everything.
I forgot that was a warning. We don't have Dispel Magic.
No.
I personally do not think Gilly should be the one to be involved with this one. I think that if there is a risk of explosion, having her down and out is probably a bad idea.
Bria will sign in. We technically have three healers in the group.
Because Iku, right?
Yes. And myself.
No, you're talking about us. And
I
then...
I haven't exhausted any of my spots for the day.
Okay, that's good. And then...
Just saying. So if anybody goes down...
You want me to touch it?
I can probably push some buttons. Doesn't seem that hard.
But Rixer, you're a really great catcher.
I'll like tie you to me. Yes. There we go.
Tie? Oh, like, so then if I go backwards, then. But what happens if you go backwards and I go backwards?
Huh. We almost said the problem is it blasts everybody that's up here.
Huh.
So if we're all up here and it fails again, we're all going blind.
Concept. You two, and Gilly points to Ravain and Brielle, touch the buttons, I'll get down and get back to the spot that's safe, and then when you both go flying, not saying that you will, but you might, when you both go flying, Rixer will catch you, bring you to me, I will heal you guys, and then we'll leave.
Yeah, I've got two hands.
Iku will say that I would be happy to stand below and attempt to catch anyone who flies off the ledge.
Rixer will look down. His hands.
Brielle.
Ravain. I got this, Iku. You can stay over there. Don't get hurt.
Iku smiles and says, Thank you, Rixer. It is so kind that you think of my safety. I don't know why you guys are laughing.
Does that sound like plan?
Yeah, sure. Good.
So when you two go flying again, we get to go?
Let's do the door.
Okay, wait! Rick's so down!
Oh, okay.
Help!
Rick's will take you down off from the ledge and then kind of like swing you a little bit over the like next 5-foot spot so you can just like plop land right next to Iku.
Whee!
Sam, for the continued risk assessment that you're doing and planning and strategizing, you can have a point of inspiration.
Yes! Wait, I got a point of inspiration for something in the group chat the other day.
Oh, that was for making chili.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you got two now. Yes. Except that you can only have one.
Oh. I have an awesome 1 point of inspiration.
Inspiration can be passed on to other players. Can that be used on saves?
I... Sure, why not?
I'm honestly not 100% sure on that.
I'm not sure either. Sure. For right now, sure, why not?
I believe inspiration just allows you to re-roll a die. So...
Yeah.
Well, it doesn't allow you to just re-roll, it gives you advantage. Yeah. Believe.
Yeah. And before you know whether or not it's a success or failure.
Yeah.
Yep.
Which often you can probably guess at certain levels.
Okay.
So, folks, what is about to happen?
They're climbing down.
We're climbing up.
Well, I'm already up there.
So, Ravain and Brielle stand before the door. There is a 4x4 grid pattern on the door. You can see four tiles, one on each row, very faintly illuminated. It's the same pattern that you found to be safe on the floor below.
Rixer's got his arms up in the air, ready to catch them.
Do you guys remember the buttons?
They're glowing.
Oh, right! I forgot.
I go high, you go low.
So are we touching them and continuously touching them, or are
touching
we...
them at the same time?
Okay.
But like, push and let go, or hold?
Sure. Push and hold. Sure.
So, two very nervous elves stand side by side in front of this door.
Brielle's like holding her breath.
Brielle is going low and Rubain is going high. Mm-hmm. And you stand there for a moment and you count down, okay, on a count of three, one, two, three, and the two of you touch the four squares at the same time.
It's a con save, right?
I'm on the wrong page. Make me a constitution saves.
Yep. Natural 20.
Nice.
Neat.
Not so much.
You had 22 total.
13.
That's what you needed. However, you guys each take 9 points of thunder damage. And you kind of get blown backwards a little bit away from the door, but not nearly enough to knock you off the edge. And you hear the boom!
Okay, we can go now, right?
Brielle's getting very frustrated.
One after another.
Can you guys give me you're giving me a situational insight check as you collect yourselves and you probably stand there re-examining the clues of the door. Jesus.
Eight.
And I don't want to make this too easy, guys. I'm sorry. Your DC was 15 here. Y'all just be confused all over the place. Iku is going to make a situational inside check. So if you ask her, she would tell you that she's never actually been in here before.
I think we did ask her.
Holy crap. So I got a 19 on the die.
Holy balls.
And I don't have her stats in front of me, but I'm pretty sure it's going to be in the low 20s. Okay. I'll explain something to you after the game about how things just changed here for you. But Iku is going to say to you, you know, I really feel like the crocodile riding atop the shoulders of the man is crucial to this puzzle. And if you and I'm trying to look at this painting on the wall up there with you as she stands down below. It does appear that while they're both reaching out for the door at the same time, it does appear the man's hand is making contact with the door, while the crocodile's is not quite yet.
I was wondering about this. Yeah, they were going to make us monkey. But I figured maybe getting away with just pushing once at the same time is going to be okay.
Do you guys want me back up there? I know I'm smaller. Brio, I've like piggybacked with you a couple times. I am small.
We can try it.
Good insight, Iku.
I do not know if it's good or bad until you make a test.
Yes, sir.
And how we interpret this is still up in the air.
Brielle says she'll take another blow. She'll do this.
Okay, do you want me up there?
She says sure, you're the lightest.
Okay.
I'll get down then.
Rixer!
Yep.
Back up there!
Okay. Grab Gilly and give her a toss up.
Yeet! And she's up.
Alright. Mommy, can you, like, give me a half kneel so I can climb up on you?
Yeah, she'll squat down.
Alright. So you first, right? And then I'll push the buttons after you?
Yeah, that was the order that the painting is in.
Okay.
Whenever you're ready. Wait. Rixer, are Are you ready to catch?
Yep.
Okay.
Both arms up in the air.
Woo!
So I guess Brielle will push the two bottom ones.
And then Gilly will wait until Brielle's second hand has made contact with the second button, then push the third and the fourth.
The buttons, calling them buttons is not necessarily accurate, but the tiles, glow very brightly and flash once, and then they go dark. And
hands back.
For a half second, everything is still, and then the wooden door swings inward.
Sure, that person is going to wear the piggy bag. Stupid penguin.
So the door.
Why couldn't I accept that was a stupid answer?
Like, yeah, that's. I was like, nah, that can't be the answer. That's stupid. No, leave it to DD modules.
Right. Jungle Temple.
Before you see a much larger chamber than what you have encountered thus far in this hallway. There is a 10 by 10 kind of entryway, which opens into a dusty 40-foot high, 20-foot wide chamber. It's littered with dinosaur bones. Cobwebs stretch from the walls to a 30-foot tall central pillar, coiled around which is a narrow stone staircase, its steps covered with dust. Carved into the pillar are reliefs of a man carrying a crocodile. The reliefs follow the stairs to the top of the pillar, on which sits a large, beautiful ceramic jug.
So let me just assume here that one of us needs to be carried by the other one up the steps.
I'm already carrying one person. We might as well just keep going with it. I'd like to make a perception check for any traps or anything.
Do it.
Are you trained in perception?
I am not.
Okay. I was going to say you're on my back, so if you were, you could help me.
You're going to choose to cover your eyes.
That's not bad. Let's see. Perception, that's a plus 3, so that's a 19.
You're looking for traps?
Yeah.
You don't really see any. You don't see any pressure plates. You don't see any collapsible floor pieces. You don't see any, you know, slits in the wall where a blade might swing out, or you don't see any holes where it could shoot arrows or release poisonous gas.
Okay.
The ceiling looks like it could be a little rocky, and some of the stones up top look loose, but nothing is moving. Nothing really, like, appears to be disturbed in any way. You don't see any kind of, like, trip wires or floor tiles that look like if you stand on them, it's going to trigger anything.
Right.
So from the doorway, you don't see any traps.
All right. I guess with Gilly still on my back, I'll start going forward.
Do you guys want to come up? There's space up here now for you.
Sure.
Yes.
Alright, so Rixer and Ruvain and Iku will enter the kind of the 10 by 10 square, like, kind of entrance hall or entrance corridor to this larger room. So if you're really looking at it, it's basically like a 4x4 square with a 2x2 square stuck to the side of it. Once Brielle and Gilly get fully into this room, like I said, carved in this pillar are reliefs of the man carrying the crocodile, and then painted along three of the four walls. The wall that the entranceway to the hallway comes in is painted to look like the entrance to a craggy cave. But the other four walls depict the man carrying a crocodile. It looks like progressively higher and higher up a mountain.
Is there any part of the story that we remember where he was carrying the crocodile at the moment?
That's what I was trying to recall.
The story that Iku told you, it was very simple. It was just the man carried the crocodile through the realms of land.
Yeah, no specifics.
No specifics. The only specific was a river, and that was the crocodile carrying the man across the river.
So I think...
And then he tricked him, and he ended up carrying
the cross.
Yeah. I think the clues are just the paintings themselves. Like, in the painting, he's carrying them up the mountain, so carry them up the stairs. Like, I think that's...
I mean, I've got Gilly on my back, so I'll just keep going. Mm-hmm.
I'm not quite sure I can carry Rixer.
So do you...
Well, vice versa.
So, Gilly carrying... I'm sorry. Brielle carrying Iku, you stand at the foot of the spiral staircase.
Gilly?
Yes.
What did I say?
Iku.
Brielle, it's just Gilly. A total pulse situation now.
You guys just, like, you're all on top of each other's shoulders. You're creating your own Batari battle stack.
No, just skip the stairs and just stack.
We'll do, like, what they do in Inside Out, and they just stack up, and then they, like, slump over and get to where they want to go. They all fall.
Spoilers!
The end of Lego Batman 2 when they all, like, stand at each other's heads and, like,
grab together. Yeah.
So you stand at the foot of the stairs.
Yeah.
The rest of the Jokers, do you enter in the big room or do you stay in the little entryway?
Rixer will probably go right into the room. I mean, not very far in.
He can walk in and nothing happens.
Yeah.
Okay. When you said it, like, oh no.
I would stay off of the stairs just in case only one set of feet need to go up at a time.
Okay.
So, now that you're right next to the stairs, you can see that there are a total, because I'm sure you would take the time to count, a total of 30 steps.
Oh, wow.
And each one is 1 foot higher than the next. Now, with a creature, now that you're carrying someone else, your standard movement becomes 15 feet.
Right.
We're not really in combat, but per round, essentially.
Right.
So here's effectively how this is going to have to happen. Your intention, obviously, is to climb the stairs.
Yep.
Do you do anything before you do that?
I don't have anything to prep myself, so, I mean...
At least I'm not as heavy as a crocodile.
True.
He really smiles.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing I can... If this is going to be an endurance the way I think it is, I don't think I have anything for myself. So.
Well, it's probably actually a little bit simpler.
Hopefully I'm overthinking it.
Although the consequences might be deadly.
I mean, that's typical.
You each... will need to make me acrobatics checks as you balance your way up these stairs. Because the stairs are 2 feet wide.
Okay.
So they're relatively narrow, especially for
okay.
balancing somebody on your shoulder. What's up, Dana?
2 feet, this way.
Okay. Out, they're sticking two feet out from the pillar.
Okay.
And they're 1 foot high. So you can move 15 in one round, 15 feet in one round, because Braille's doing actual walking.
Right.
Give me your dexterity checks. Or acrobatics checks for you.
Inspiration.
I have dexterity, duh.
God help me.
21.
8.
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty low.
Yeah.
So you're lucky I'm just rereading this stuff as you guys are rolling. So Brielle is doing this pretty easily, right? She's doing just fine. And then just as you kind of... Brielle takes a step, and Brielle can feel Gilly, who's trying to stay balanced and keep her arms out and, you know, that kind of thing, start to, like, overcorrect. And slide and slip, and she's trying to, like, grab her legs tighter against Brielle's shoulders, and Brielle is able to, like, throw a hand up and steady Gilly and keep her in place. So you guys have successfully gone halfway up this pillar.
Oh, this is really high.
Now, if you want to get to the top, you need to each give me another dexterity or acrobatics check.
That is one less than last time.
Six.
But Brielle's total is...
What did I say last time? 20, 21?
21,
22? Well, it's 20.
Okay.
Because 16 plus 4.
Same sort of deal. You guys are rounding, getting close to the top. And Gilly has been able to kind of like balance a little bit against the center of the pillar to help keep herself steady as Brielle moves.
Remains just at the base, it's like gripping under Mixer.
as Brielle gets to the top and Gilly no longer has essentially a wall to balance against, she slips. But it's another thing where Brielle is like so hyper focused, she's able to kind of like put both hands up this time and for a second just kind of pause as she kind of like holds onto Gilly's sides and like holds her in place above her head. As Brielle then kind of catches her breath and just continues to walk forward. But the two of you are now standing 30 feet in the air. At Brielle's feet sits this clay jug.
How big is it? Is it just like a normal size jug?
If I were to hold my hands about like this, I could give you an idea. A little bit bigger around than a milk jug, and about half again as tall, or a gallon of milk.
Okay.
It's about 1.5 times the size of a milk jug. But made, has a narrow base, flutes out wide, and then kind of narrows back again very, very tight to a top, and there's a cork, keeping it closed.
Is there any etchings in it? Or is it just blank?
Do you want to refocus your attentions to carefully examine this thing, or stay balanced?
I mean, I have a pass of 16, if that helps.
Yeah.
So I'm not, like looking around, I'm just kind of
passively
holding her and then taking a glance, I guess.
Passively with a 16, I'll give you, it has a maze pattern carved kind of all the way around it. It's kind of like the blocky sort of style of mazes that you have seen many places thus far.
I don't know if I would take the risk of sitting you down.
I don't know. My dice have rolled a 3, a 4, and a 5.
And I don't know if we just want to pick it up.
Right.
What do you
want to
do?
Is my attention so focused on not falling that I can't roll for anything else? Like,
what do you want to do?
Like a perception to see if there's like a weight plate underneath the jug, whereas picking it up would trigger something catastrophic.
A giant rock falling at us.
I feel like
down the stairs.
I feel like Gilly. I mean, she is focusing on being balanced.
Right.
So you need to tell me if she needs to, like, kind of, like, refocus her attention and mental energy onto really examining something critically to look for, as you say, a pressure pad or a trap or something.
Can I, like, just kneel down to kind of give myself a more sturdy support and then hold her to, like, steady myself?
Like, step back down a step?
No, like, how big is the platform that we're on where this thing is at? Is there room to kneel down or do anything?
I am going to rule, because of course, none of the stuff is in the book that detailed, that it is, the step stops, and then there is 2 feet of just straight up pillar, and then this thing is on top of that.
Okay.
Sam?
I was going to say, can I reposition myself so I'm not, like, sitting on Brielle's shoulders? I'm more, like, grappled around her back.
Like piggyback style as opposed to...
Right.
Like a sloth.
Game of chicken or something in the water or chicken fillet kind of deal?
Right.
Yeah,
because sure. That would give me some more stability and then I could get closer to look.
You could do that.
Okay.
If you take the time to really not, you know, move around a bunch. Yeah, you can do that.
Yeah. So I'm going to slowly, like, maneuver myself down so I'm, like, a backpack for Brielle. And then I will proceed. Or should I investigate for traps? We're doing investigation,
right? Well, it's right in front of you, yes.
Okay, there we go. There 18. We
go. You do not see anything.
Hey, Brielle. I think we can take this jug. And then I'm going to solve the maze at the bottom.
Okay. Gilly says it's okay to grab it, so Brielle just reaches out and grabs it. Picks it up.
You have a jug in your hand.
Go, go, she holds go! It up. No! As Gilly's, like, grappled around her, just go down the stairs.
Suppress those adventure instincts to smash jugs.
There might be rupees inside.
Yeah, there could be rupees inside.
I'm supposed to get them.
All right, so Brielle has the jug in one hand. Gilly is currently being worn as a backpack. What's going on now?
Head back down the stairs.
All right, are you staying backpack mode?
Backpack mode.
You've got the jug in your hand? Mm-hmm. Cool. You guys need to give me a dexterity check, Matt. Brielle will have disadvantage because she has a thing in her hand.
I'll take the... That's not too bad. 17.
5.
Well.
How?
Gilly is really thinking a lot about this maze. And trying to, like, catch a look at it and trying to think about it and kind of loses focus for a second and starts to slide off of Brielle's shoulders, and Brielle can kind of feel it, and holding the jug in her right hand is going to quickly snap her hand back over her own shoulder and kind of grab hold of Gilly's collar and pull her back up so that Gilly can reposition and stay attached. Okay.
Digging into Rixer's arm, chewing on cloak.
Side-eye. Gilly, like, you need to stop.
I don't know what's happening.
All right, you guys have 15 feet to go.
We're 15 feet?
We have 15 feet to go. Because it takes... It's 30 feet long. We have half movement.
Right.
Yeah. So we got one more check.
Could someone conceivably catch a halfling from 15 feet in the air without doing damage to anybody?
If you want to dismount off of Brielle's back.
Do you want me to sit the pot down and yeet you over to Rixer?
That's what I'm thinking. Because I'm sucking at these rolls.
But what if me throwing you off sets off a trap?
That's fair. Okay, let's just do it. But I guess Gilly will say, if I slip like that again, throw me towards Rixer. Rixer, are you ready to catch?
Okay. Rixer will go over next to the pillar.
Okay, Rixer's next to the pillar.
Oof. I had disadvantage, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't need to roll again. Because that's a 1.
Yeah, me. Hey, Sam, what you got?
7.
So here's the fun thing. Here's how this works. Both characters have to fail the DC 10 acrobatics check.
Oh, really?
In order to fail, right?
What'd you get, Sam?
7.
Oh.
So, a moment ago, when Brielle reached backwards and dramatically grabbed hold of Gilly's collar to save her, unbeknownst to Gilly, and Matt, this is happening because you got a 1.
Yeah.
Brielle accidentally unclasps part of the armor and the, you know, bindings of Gilly's, she's wearing.
Right.
And as she is hanging on for dear life, trying to stay balanced, Gilly, because of this previous malfunction of her equipment, things kind of shift dramatically, and all the weight of her packs and gear and stuff shifts to one side, and you guys slide sideways and slip off of the side of the pillar at about step 15.
And can Rixer try to catch them both?
Them both?
I mean, they're essentially attached together.
That's fair. I'll let you have a reaction for this. Rixer, give me a acrobatics or athletics check as you attempt to, you know, save the day.
I'll go with athletics. And that is 22. I have been very closely keeping my eye on them. and I see the clasp come undone and all of the weight shift it's happening and get ready.
Catch. You beat a 20. So you beat a hard thing, because saving them both is going to be hard. You're able to very much just, like, grab hold of Gilly, except, like, the rest of her packs and stuff kind of come off in her hand, but you've slowed the fall so she's not hurting herself.
Okay.
But she's no longer attached to Brielle's back. And Brielle, you kind of, like, grab hold of her around the waist, and she kind of, like, slumps against your shoulder. Brielle, give me a, another acrobatics check and hang on to your jug.
What's my bonus again? Oh, yeah. You said check, not saving throw?
Check.
Okay, that's a little
bit more. Oh, well, maybe you're not going to take damage, so it's a check.
Okay. 13.
You're able to keep your hand firmly on this jug. And because you're still holding this jug, even though you're no longer together, nothing happens. Gilly's like, standing there, and Rixer's got most of Gilly's gear in one hand, and Brielle over his shoulder in the other, and Ruvain is like chewing his nail, like clawing his face, like, oh no! But y'all are okay.
Rixer's gonna put both of them down, just like it's no big deal.
Rixer, thank you! And Gilly, like, jumps into her pack of stuff and pulls out a treat bar.
Oh, hey. Thanks.
No, thank you!
I mean, it's just like catching bales of hay.
Except it was my life, and you saved me. Us.
Okay, thanks.
And eats Brielle's, the food. Brielle signs thank you and then hugs Rixer.
Rixer's got like a really, really stupid smile on his face, and thankfully he's so much taller than Brielle, she doesn't see it.
This place is
so... She probably comes up to like here, like, just below the chest line.
So you guys are standing in this room. Ryan, what's
Ruvain? I was going to say Ruvain's just watching this. Fascinating.
This place is stupid. Let's go. Can I have my stuff back, please?
What? The treat that I just ate?
You had...
It's like still in Rixer's hand.
So like Gilly like leaped up into her pack.
Okay. I guess I was like, imagining if they were on the floor when we were doing that, but okay. Yes, we'll give it back to Gilly.
Gilly gears back up.
And, yeah, it's a matter of something came unclasped, and her backpack and whatever other armors or something can be reattached pretty easily.
I'm solving this maze outside. I want to go outside now.
Ruvain.
Yes.
You've got a pretty good look at this item that,
Sure, I would like to, yeah.
I mean, no, you can see it pretty well. And because of what it is, while the pattern on the jug is not something you've probably seen before, the maze pattern, you do immediately recognize what it is.
Oh, I can't flip the cards. I just...
No, you would know what it is.
All right. Make sure it is what...
So what I think it is?
I think you know what
it
is, yeah. Then I will communicate my beliefs. I'll say, that looks like it's one of those magic containers that can produce liquids.
Oh.
Such as mayonnaise for food, or...
I have one of these in Ryan's game. Or I had beer. One before I threw it off the boat.
Beer. Or fresh water.
Oh. That's water. Helpful. Would... I guess... Kelly's rolling intelligence to see if she's come into contact or knowledge of that before. Yeah. So, it's over 20.
They're not, like, the most common thing in the world, but... I mean, if you went to a proper school where they taught magical stuff, you would definitely encountered one of these or heard of these.
I do have the sage thing that, like, oh yeah, you know where to find stuff and information about it.
Oh, I've heard of one of those, so I don't have to solve the puzzle on the outside.
See, I don't know about the puzzles, right?
You've never, I mean, yeah, you haven't seen these puzzles before.
Yeah.
Right. New to Chalt.
Because Ryan started thinking, like, it might be a good idea to solve it anyway, because that advice was, you find a puzzle, you solve it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I don't think it requires it.
Huh. Gilly walks up to it. Water!
And it... I mean, if you just walk up to it and just say water, nothing's going to happen.
I don't think you have to like walk up inside
him. Now, are you going to, like,
grab it?
Open the cork and pour something out of it? Like,
no, she, like...
You can, like, you can hear something sloshing around in there.
No, I think it works. Let's go, though. I want to check outside. Can we go outside? I want to go outside.
Okay, let's go.
Yeah, let's head back.
I have a worry.
What?
Yeah, the other traps are still active.
The only one we don't know how to get past is the wall blades. Right?
I have a feeling you know how to get past that now.
Describe what you guys are doing. You can go back out to the other side of the doorway. And the hallway that you came in on and looks the same as it did. It's very dark, but you can see daylight out the other side.
I guess head back down the way we came. Follow the trail from on the floor. Follow the button patterns. Make sure we step on the right ones.
You're totally able to do that. I think Ruvain actually had left arcane marks of some sort.
Yeah, and they might be coming.
The green orb would be.
Yeah, that only lasts like a minute.
Yeah, but the other two last an hour. Yeah. He never took a short rest.
Totally has not been an hour since you did that. You guys are standing on the ledge looking down at the area where you know there is a blade trap. And you can, if those of you with dark vision can see that the pit trap is still open.
So the only, we never figured out how to stop the blades. Or what triggers the blades.
A common theme so far is that one person needs to carry another. And if the abjuration mark is... checking for that. Perhaps the same is true for this hallway.
I mean, I can try putting Gilly in my back again and walking across.
Is that what you do?
Okay.
If that's what the plan is.
Yeah, let's try it.
Are you playing...
we're going to backpack it.
You're going to backpack it?
Mm-hmm.
All right, cool.
Looking at the painting again, it's just vines and snakes and him walking through the forest, right?
Just walking through the forest. And you, it's like, it looks like a jungle because you can see some vines and you can see some snakes in the trees.
Okay. I guess, yeah. Hop down off the ledge and then help her down and then just piggyback.
You
like we did.
Clear the zone without triggering blades.
Aha!
I tell you to slink around the hole.
Okay. Uh-oh.
And then kind of give a thumbs up to the other two.
I mean, they can clear as day see you.
Don't know how we're going to get
Iku
across.
Wixer can probably carry two people.
Yeah, I was just going to say.
Iku would also tell you that she can manage.
Okay.
So
she's got them cheat codes.
Ruvane carries Wixer across?
Yes, obviously.
No.
Other way around, cool. Yeah, Wixer can, you know, pick up Ruvane, put it on his shoulders, and hop down the 7 feet and walk clear the...
Just, it's a good orc. It's a good orc. Not a bad orc. Good orc.
And then you guys are standing in front of the open pit trap. Which... now that you've been paying attention to the drawings or the paintings on the wall, there is a painting along the walls of this first room that depict the man standing atop the crocodile as it crosses a river.
So you'd still have to piggyback.
But at this point,
the trap's open. Already open. Oh. Yeah.
Gilly would have started to skirt around the pit.
If you take your time, you can, you know, scooch along the edge.
Rael's going to get a little bit of a running start.
Yeah, that's another question right there. Is there enough room to get that running start to make that?
Actually, strictly speaking, there is not. Mm. Well, not, I mean, unless you're going to, like, cross the room with the blades.
No.
Rickster will just throw anybody who's okay with it.
Right.
I mean, it's only 10 foot. Yeah.
Okay, I'll just sink around it. Screw it.
You can take a little longer.
It takes a little longer, but...
If you want to go ahead and throw me, go ahead.
I mean, would Ravain let an orc throw him?
No. Across?
Yeah, so...
I guess I'll skirt around the edge.
You can skirt around the edge.
Okay.
So without the running start, what is it again for the long jump?
A long jump. Move 10 feet. Okay, sorry. If you cannot move 10 feet,
mm-hmm.
when you make a standing long jump, you jump half of your strength score.
Okay, yeah. Well...
You'd have to have a 20 to make it.
I have a 19. And I think, actually, we did this before. And because there's a little ledge...
It's 1 foot in and 1 foot in.
Yep, so we're fine.
You can make it. Because it's only 18 feet, right?
Mm-hmm.
Total?
Mm-hmm.
All right, cool. As you guys are being very carefully trying to skirt around the edge, and Rixir is jumping, Iku jumps through, and you guys hear the blades swing, and she kind of grunts a little bit, but makes it to the other side, and then jumps across the opening.
Okay.
Iku, you can see her kind of, like, dusting her self off a little bit. Oh no, I am, thank you. I'm fine, but thank you very much.
She says that, but does she look injured?
No. Alright, folks, so you have, against all odds, been able to successfully clear the House of the Crocodile, found at Camp Righteous, which is the name of the camp in front of you. You have acquired a magical jug which can produce fresh water or beer or vinegar or mayonnaise and possibly some other things too.
What about mustard?
You'll have to read the card, Dana, and find out.
Okay.
So I think that brings us to a close of today's episode. Sam?
Hey, that's all for tonight. Thanks for listening. If you want to get to know us better, you can find us on the Facebook, the Twitter, the Instagram, at Monday Night TPK. You can also find Monday Night TPK at Above the Table Games on YouTube. Don't forget to rate us and review us on iTunes. Thanks for listening, and we'll always save a seat at the table for you. Tomorrow there's pie.
Like, are spell slots as a meta concept, a thing that actually exists?
That's what I was just thinking
in
about.
This universe.
How do you know the power level of...
Right.
Same reasons how you know how strong you are.
I feel like a wizard who has attended wizarding university and school proper training might actually be able to fluently talk in those terms. But like sorcerer who pulls magic out of her ass and literally just like flings it, maybe not. You know, warlock whose power is just from Satan himself. I can shoot fire out of my fingertips until I get tired. And then I can catch my breath and do it again sometimes. Oh man, now I'm level 18. I can do it like twice before I gotta catch my breath.
Well, and also go ahead.
No, I remember one of the Driss books. The wizards were having a contest to see if you can kill the most zombies. And they were sitting there like blasting their spells and everything. And at the end, the captain of the ship scolds them like, great, now we have to go through this with our wizards severely lacking their spells. So it is canon that they are limited.
Okay.
But like, what about a cleric who like studies?
Yeah.
Yeah. You would
sort of the same school of thought as a wizard who can be well versed in these things.
That's what I was thinking.
With the being like a sorcerer and stuff like that, though. I think it'd be more confusing of knowing exactly how much they could do, especially because of like casting something from a higher spell level, like spell slot.
I mean, I see casting spells. Oh, I thought you were
gonna... No, I'm just like so then it'd be like, well, sometimes I can cast like 5 spells, but if I cast this spell and then this spell, I'm done for the day.
Yeah, that's where I was just about to go, like, cuz I feel like you'd get exhausted. Your casting spells is burning up your energy.
Mm-hmm.
So you can be like, I can cast 3 spells a day. I've cast 2. I'm probably going to only be able to do 1 more.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know.
That makes a lot of sense, yeah. Just feeling it out from just like a, I have a headache. Mm-hmm. You know, I feel mentally drained or however it works.
Yeah. I feel like you know how much energy you have to be able to cast so many spells.
Mm-hmm.
But typically I can get 3 spells, and then as you progressively train and get better, then you can do more.
Right, and you would realize that, like, oh, I can do more now.
Yeah.
It's a matter of not just building up your own personal stamina, but maybe just also awareness of what you can really do if you push yourself.
Mm-hmm.
With sorcerers especially, with, like, the metamagic sorcery points.
Oh, yeah.
Being able to, like, okay, if I really focus, I can bend a thing a certain way, or I can kind of improv. Sorcerer is like an improv kind of
In the vein of like being aware of spells, something like that, Goblin Slayer, they talk about that.
3 spells.
Do they?
Yeah. Like the cleric, like several times he'll ask her like, how many miracles do you have left?
Oh, or something like that.
Yeah. And she'll be like, I can do 2 of this, or I can do 1 of this and 2 of these.
Yeah.
And then the shaman druid type guy, he'll be like, specifically know, like, I can do 1 of this and 1 of this and 1 of this. That's interesting.
This might represent a higher level of magical learning and awareness of what the, especially with the whole like 5e Faerun, like you're tapping into the weave of magic and bending. Right. Bending strands in certain way to have certain effects.
Yeah, but so they definitely like address the limitations and are aware, like they, you know, they talk about it kind of meta, but it doesn't feel out of place.
I mean, there's a way to meta it, but make it also feel natural the way you're talking about it.
Oh, absolutely.
As long as you do it right. That's like, you know, how when people are damaged and people want to get healed or whatever, you know, you could just look at somebody and know they're getting their ass kicked. Instead of being like, hey, how much HP do you have?
Right.
You know, how beat up are you? Or how beat up does your character look?
Yeah,
you'd be like,
that's a good one.
I'm cut up all over. I'm bleeding out.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Well, and also, like, for the character being able to say, like, I can probably only take 1 more good hit.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, okay, so you're pretty low. Like, you maybe only have,
like
10 to 20.
I'm looking exhausted. Yeah. I'm probably about to collapse onto my knees.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Because that's a meta way of getting around the meta of, oh, I have 6 out of 20 HP left. Yeah. Be like, no, I look like I'm about to collapse. Mm-hmm. You know, I might be able, like you said, I might be able to take one more hit from this guy. I'm going down.
Mm-hmm. I actually think of towards the end of the last game we played, Matt, where I remember once Glory dropped her big level, like, 7 or 8 heal spell, where it's, like, 500 HP to within a 30-foot radius, or whatever it is.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of, like, how to explain divvying up this quantity of 500 from person to person to person.
Yeah.
And I know it worked out that, like, I could expend the whole thing and everybody was back at full. I think it was how that kind of worked out. But, like, if that wasn't the case, like, oh, you only get, like, I could push a little bit more towards, you know, Sam, but I'm going to push it towards Maggie instead. Right. I don't know, like, that kind of, like, nitpicky for some of the magic stuff becomes, like, hard to describe without using numbers. Sorry, Sam. Yeah.
No. I was going to say maybe, like, if there's some sort of effect with your healing power, like, maybe swirls of, because it was Glory, swirls of bright light.
Sure.
And maybe somebody glows brighter than another.
Mm-hmm.
Like, until it absorbs into their skin.
You could try to, like, describe that, like, maybe Sam's character needed it more, but she was closer.
Yeah.
So she absorbed more of the light, and you can, I guess, describe it visually like that.
Or even, like, it could be, like, little, like, sparks or something that shoot off, so, like, 3 of them land on Sam. 1 of them goes to other character.
Sure, sure.
Like, depending on exactly what your character's thing is.
Your theme.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just gonna chuck a tooth at you.
Did Ash do any kind of healing whatsoever in that game?
To herself.
She just healed herself. No, I get that. What? Like, when I played Longguard, like, he's a cleric. He healed himself.
I mean, she's only a bard, so I didn't do it a lot even, but I mean, there, I probably healed other people a couple times, but mostly it was just, like, I need to be able to take care of myself.
Sure.
And that really didn't become too much of a problem once Glory came in, because she had the healing everybody else. So,
flippin' love sorcerers, man. Sorcerers are so much fun to play.
They're so great. There's so many different ways you can play one.
It's like sorcerers and warlocks in terms of, like, backgrounds and stories.
Yeah.
Like, I love them so much, but whenever we get your game, a part of me wants to dive into, like, one of those for a fun background.
Uh-huh.
I've never in my life played a monk. I've never in my life played a paladin. Ever. Like, I want to play new classes. But I love my favorite classes so much. It's like, oh my god.